Okay, so I guess we'll go ahead and get started if you want. If you have the handout, the case of Grandpa Miguel. This is also make sure you stay alert. Ask you to rifle through your stuff.
Yeah, right. If I don't see
you, I didn't make you stand up and do jumping jacks, so I didn't, instead I'm going to have you rifle through your paperwork. So yeah, the case where he presented to the emergency room, and so if you look on the back after the non-pain symptom management presentation, you notice that he improved after the recommendations. His workup revealed metastatic renal cell carcinoma, and then based on his comorbidities, functional status, and advanced illness, the medical oncology team does not offer any further therapy except for supportive care. They were very happy that the palliative team is involved, and during the hospitalization, his girlfriend was always at his bedside, but no other family members were ever usually noted by staff or anyone else, as usual when you go by and try and catch them, you know. And the patient and girlfriend informed of the bad news. His improvement prompted discharge planning. Social work approached him about advanced directives. He indicated that his girlfriend Mary would be his voice if he would no longer be able to speak for himself. And then paperwork was attempted, but Mr. Miguel at that time was too tired from his physical therapy, he said, to sign any forms. Later that night, though, you're called to the floor because he was coding, and you find Mr. Miguel in respiratory distress. He's intubated. RT helps you with mechanical ventilator parameters. And then several days later, he remains unresponsive and dependent on the ventilator. The ICU physicians believe his prognosis is poor. Mary is very upset because she recalls that he said he never would like to live like a vegetable. And however, she did not recall talking about advanced directives or power of attorney. And of course, then his family arrives after multiple attempted phone calls and phone messages by the ICU team. And his daughter and grandson agree to meet with the ICU team. As usual, whenever families that are estranged to meet with others, Mary joined the meeting, who is his girlfriend and a significant other at least at that time, and told Mr. Miguel's family about wish was not to live like a vegetable. His grandson interrupted, saying, "You're not part of our family," which is, I'm sure you've seen that in family dynamics. Don't need to go there any further. What would you know about Grandpa Miguel? He never mentioned you, and his mind was not too good either. Mr. Miguel's grandson asked Mary to leave the room, actually. So a lot of times misplaced feelings and other things get in the way, too, because, again, you're seeing him now, but you don't know how the last 85 years have been and everything involved besides the usual grief, denial, and other things, the steps of grief. So sometimes, regardless of their reasoning, people... there's not a right way to respond to bad news for everyone. And his family decided to continue life support for as long as it was needed, because after all, they will see a miracle. And the grandson stated, and they did not listen to Mr. Miguel's girlfriend. And what about Grandpa Miguel's wishes, though? What are some of the discussions? I'm sure y'all have seen this before on your team. The one consistent thing about family dynamics is they tend to be very dynamic, and the one consistency is they're inconsistent and dynamic. So I'm sure y'all have seen this case. And so what are your kind of personal feelings, or which way would you go with this in your institution, or how would you handle it?
I would probably get Dr. Ratliff involved, and she is our psychologist on the unit who is involved in a lot of the hospice care. She I have found to be very instrumental in resolving these kinds of conflicts. She's a wonderful mediator. And, you know, I think my first instinct would be to use your resources, those people that in the past have helped you resolve these difficult issues. Bring the family to the table. You're not going to resolve it always in the first meeting, but at least you can get the issues out on the table. And then you break up, and then plan another meeting in a couple of days. And that's, it's kind of like, get Dr. Ratliff in here quick.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, and sometimes it's really kind of aggravating almost. You feel like this family, you know, well, obviously they haven't talked in 20 years, but then you forget the dynamics from a psychological viewpoint from the family. Mm-hmm. Are they having delayed, you know, guilt? You know, why I wasn't involved? You know, he can't die now, I haven't yelled at him yet. Mm-hmm. You know, there's some of these dynamics. He's not going to go unless I yell at him first. There's a lot of things that we don't know about that's happened in their past, so we can't ever really judge one side or the other. In addition to the time of the crisis, you know, whenever palliative care workers or someone else has a family member with a terminal illness, I always like to remind them that they themselves need to be a patient. You know, you have the right to have be irrational at times. You know, you don't have to be the one that stands up and knows the right answer all the time. You know, turn off the doctor, turn off the nurse, turn off the, if you want to be the blathering idiot daughter, it's your right. You know, you have that time, and you need to have that time, or else you're going to have really delayed grief yourself. So you got to really kind of understand, sometimes you jump to, you know, where are these loons coming from? But then you got to kind of look at it over. And that's why I think psychology is a great perspective. And as you said, if the guy's been on the ventilator, I hate to say it, you know, for a week, what's another day to make sure that everybody has enough time to let that soak in? Some people just need some time to realize that, you know, to kind of process the information. So the first thing, even though your first reflexive thing, your blood pressure goes up 20 points, you got to kind of realize, you know, let me step back and let me realize, because I don't know what all happened between Grandpa Miguel and so-and-so who showed up, you know, for the last 20 years or so. But the overall line theme is advanced care planning should really happen at earlier in life, and actually much earlier than, you know, a lot of people, you know, they worry more about putting their, making sure their mortgage is, you know, paid off, or they've got life insurance or something for the family, much less telling their family about how they would like to be treated as they've been put, you know, in the final stages of dying. So I'm like, you know, let's think about this. We've gone materialistic to the point where we're worried about the house, the car, the neighbor, the cat, and everything else. But yet, oh, like, by the way, I forgot the, you know, do I want the machine, you know, keeping me alive? So I like to keep things in perspective. And that's like on the first slide. It's important to kind of keep it in perspective. We all make decisions that come along in life. Such as weddings, births, graduation, vacations. Not everybody gets married. Not everybody has children. Not everyone gets a vacation. But not to be fatalistic, but we all, the one thing we do all have in common besides taxes is that we are all going to pass away. So really, if there's anything else you really need to take into account is, and your daily thing is to make sure your taxes are fine. And that you actually have your at least your wishes relate to others. And so planning future health care, particularly end-of-life care, is also a major decision. A lot of times I use myself an example with my patients. I don't really show my preference, but I say, well, when I filled out my advance directives, the things that you want to consider are what's important to you. I don't like to make them think, you know, my personal decisions or anything, you know, being the right answer or not. So I don't go into details unless I've really known them well or something like that. But I just say, you know, well, when I filled mine out, because again, I don't know if you all know, but I got out of the military about a year and a half ago, and that's something you have to do. You have to meet with the lawyer before you deploy. So, yeah. So they kind of help you in this advanced planning a little bit. So at least be able to tell them, because then you're also showing them how important it is, the fact you've already done it as well. A lot of people are like, you know, well, I don't know. But no, I'm like, if it's important enough that you're telling your patients, it's important enough that you've done this as well. And again, it's a discussion and documentation of one's healthcare preference. It's not an event. If by the time you've waited for an event to happen, you've really missed the ideal time. I mean, whenever I see a geriatrics patient, even when I'm on the wards, my residents tease me. They can tell when I've seen a patient before they have, because they either call me Dr. DNR or Dr. Advanced Directive, because they're like, they can actually ask the patient, has anyone talked to you about advanced directives, including, you know, DNR and support? And they'll say, yeah, someone came by, and they're like, oh, okay, that was my attending. So if anything else, you know, that's just really important. And I think it's whether they're a 20-year-old being admitted for an elective surgery, even or compared to a 90-year-old that's coming in with multiple problems. Both are just as important to find and document what their preferences are. And also based on the patient's own values and goals. And they vary with time, but not all the time. And as you, when I see them in clinic, you know, when I've seen them in year one, you can see, you know, if I have a healthy 80-year-old, and if by the time they turn 85, they've had a heart attack and CHF, they've evolved. They may change their ideas. So once labeled a full code or labeled a DNR, not necessarily always a full code or a DNR, and other preferences. And also, sometimes who they want to be their power of attorney changes too, with changes in dynamics and family structures. And so that's important to make sure they keep things up to date. And also, again, advanced care planning, the reason why I'm showing the arrow in between the two of these is it's not really written in stone. These are things that are dialogue, they're continuous, they're dynamic. The big thing is that it's open discussion, and then the other thing is whatever you come up with is you document it. Those are the two steps. And again, a person who's even a do not attempt resuscitation can change their mind. And a person who's full code, therefore, can also change their mind as well. So sometimes whenever I have a patient come to the going to a hospice unit, you know, of course you want to start pushing the do not attempt resuscitation, but at least whenever they say no, they're full code, that tells me indirectly, well, this is a person I need to see frequently to bring this up and really get to the underlying, you know, are there things they're wanting to accomplish before they die? You know, are there underlying reasons beyond them just wanting everything done? Maybe there's a son they haven't got to talk to, but they just haven't told anybody. So part of me is like, I just need to go check in there and kind of check with them daily and make sure there's not something underlying that they're not really haven't voiced yet. And then, so the instructions for medical care that are very common, of course, the living will, which is preferred in the sense that they're actually giving their choices. And of course, they vary by state. The VA, of course, every government agency has its own version. But it's nice, once you have that, at least they've actually directly marked on there something that towards their effects. And there's also personal letters, verbal statements, as long as they're credible, and hopefully in multiple places, you know, by multiple people, and not in direct contraindication or contradiction of multiple people. So that sometimes is a little shakier. And then also designation of a proxy if they were not able to make their decisions. Can you have both? Yes. If you have a proxy and a living will, that means the proxy has to work within what's in the living will, basically. So to me, if you're going to go through the trouble of a living will, just be very specific in the living will. Some people just get handed that stack, you know, when they're admitted, and they just fill it all out, and then they basically have filled out both. And so I think sometimes it's one or the other, and then if you talk mostly to a proxy, make sure they know what you want done, and I tell patients that. So, and then also the code status, which is totally separate as to what's going on. And one way I explain to family members and to patients, one thing I push about telling them their wishes is you're actually relieving a burden on your family members. If they know you wouldn't want to be put on the ventilator and stuff, that saves them at a time of great grief and crisis of having possible secondary guilt of being the one that unplugged their family member. So to me, I use that as, you know, as a thing of you're actually relieving a burden, because then the proxy to me, and I tell the proxy members when I've talked with them, is they're really just a voice for the patient. It's not their decision. Their function is really to relay to me what the family member would have wanted to have had done. So I try to separate those two so that they don't get the secondary guilt complex that might, you know, underlie some of their decision making. And then also the code status. A person can have a do not attempt resuscitation and not have either of the two forms above, which be preferred if they do, but they don't have to. Now, advanced directives, again, should be considered by anyone and everyone. Applies to all general medical treatments. And document usually requires the patient's signature. It varies by state. The forms look a little different. We even have, but whereas the DNR is really more of an institutional type form. There's even an out-of-hospital DNR. A lot of nursing homes use that as sometimes their supplement DNR form. And anytime you transport a patient from facility to facility, like if we were sending someone to one of our sister institutions for hospice or palliative care. That's one of the things we make sure they have, is an out-of-hospital DNR, if that's what their choice is. But again, it's considered by people who are high risk for not surviving resuscitation, and out-of-hospital, again, denies DNR requires patient and physician's signature. Now, why do advanced care planning? Well, they've done studies and they've shown 80% of people want to die at home, but in reality only 20% of people actually do. So there's a big gap in between what people are saying they want and what's actually happening to them. Second is 50% are not able to make decisions about their care at the end of life, whether they are delirious, whether they're under the influence of medications, whether they've been in trauma, injury, accidents. That's the worst time for these things to be coming up. And then most doctors will treat if they don't know a patient's desires, and that's pretty well, a lot of times that ties our hands a bit, and it gets complicated, and then we have to bring in others, whether it be the ethics consult, you know, the ethics committee, or other functions can help us with that. And family members sometimes do not know a person's wishes. They may know everything about that person, but some families and some even cultures have more difficulty with discussing end of life with others than you'd be surprised. And so whenever I have a patient in my clinic that tells me, I'm like, you know, who would be the person that you would want to make decisions for you? And I make that, write that down. I'm like, you know, sometime you can have a talk with them. Please let them know. You know, don't like bury the secret under a rock somewhere. And then when I come flying out of my clinic, say, oh, he didn't want this. And the family look at me like, you know, I'm crazy. So it's important that they discuss this with family members. And actually they did a survey, and this was a North Carolina survey of about 8,000 AARP members that were mailed a survey, and it said 86% of respondents at least somewhat comfortable talking about death. Half had not talked about their own wishes for end-of-life care with anyone other than family, though. Only 11% had talked to their family about the wishes of end-of-life. So really there's a big gap. I mean, even though they're willing to talk about it, a lot of times they're not willing to be the ones to think that they're to be the one to initiate the discussion. And 73% said not being able to communicate through wishes or living in pain would be worse than death itself. So we really need to think about this. And also 79% says it's important to be off life support, yet only, again, half had any advanced directives. So, then the next slide. From the patient's perspective, they think it's, they almost leave it as to the being the physician's initiation of discussions. Same thing with like herbal medications. You know, the studies show very few patients will tell you they're on an herbal, but unless the physician or provider asks them, then suddenly they'll tell you. But you know, that so it's the same way with the other discussions. And then also they're worried that the family would be upset by the planning process. Fear of burdening family members is another concern of theirs, and belief that family should decide because ultimately they know better. And then again, half the time they haven't talked to the family members, so that makes it even more difficult. And then discomfort with the topic in general. And again, that's why sometimes you have to build trust with certain patients before you can just pop in there and just say, oh, by the way, you know, you got to kind of see them a few times sometimes and at least get their stories of what's important to them as a belief and what's important to them and the aspects of living. And also some patients just are apathetic. They just assume, well, I haven't given it a good fight unless I've just had everything done, you know. And you can't go by someone just saying, well, it's in God's hands, because some people that means you've done, some people that means comfort care, other people that means ICU with everything hooked into them. So you got to really, you know, you can't really assume from some certain generalized statements that patients say as well. You've got to really dig in and find out a little bit more. And from the clinician's perspective, they are waiting a lot of times for the patient to initiate the discussions. But again, as we've seen from the patients, they're waiting for the physician. So again, no one gets anywhere. A lot of the MDs erroneously believe beliefs about appropriateness. And a lot of it's, again, the, you know, if you're seeing them in acute care and you're seeing them for this, or, well, I just saw him, or, you know, well, he's only 60 and not doing pretty well, why should I bring it up now? Again, we got to get out of this wait for a crisis time before we bring up care planning. lack of knowledge about advanced directives. A lot of providers themselves are not clear on the different types of advanced directives, what's required. They aren't comfortable with the topic that they especially don't have any knowledge about. And then time constraints. As you all know, if they've got 14 complaints, sometimes you can schedule another visit follow-up, and then the whole reason for that to be to, you know, if you can only get to their top four complaints, sometimes the only thing that you can do is schedule a soon return visit and then have that on your agenda to cover the next ones. And that could include advanced directives. Negative attitude, they don't want to be the downer, I guess, in the discussions. You know, guy's perky, you know, coming in here and, oh, I don't want to spring, you know, by the way, if on them. So that's some of the attitudes and reasonings. So what can you really do? The biggest thing you can really do is talk about that. And one of the things you can do is let the patients, introduce the topics to them and then just pretty well document the patient's preferences. And again, what you assume might be important to one person, you can't. It may be totally different, and they may even give reasons. You know, well, the reason why I don't is that I'm, you know, the primary caregiver. You need to kind of understand where they're coming from. But again, the biggest thing is to document, and then also to review and update, because as you get to know the patient again, as their health status changes over time, again, their preferences may change as well. And apply directives when the need arises. If you've already got it documented, the nice thing with the VA is once you get the advanced directives, you can get it scanned in and it becomes a permanent part of their record. So at least that way, from whenever they're hospitalized or come through the ER or something, then it's already part of their permanent record. Now, fostering advanced directives, one thing I do, especially on the inpatient side, especially since, you know, you don't have that trust thing built up and you're just walking into their room, a lot of times I bring up, sir, this is something we have to do by law. We have to ask everybody what their wishes are. Whether you're 20 with no medical problems or whether you're 100, I need to know what you would like to have done. And I just bring it up to them. I said, well, if we do things to you that you wouldn't want to have done, that's basically assault and battery. I said, my reason for asking you is so that I don't accidentally do something to you that you wouldn't want to have done to you. I said, that's the way I'm coming at it. So I'm not judgmental. I'm just asking them, what is your preference? And again, what would you like to have done? And that's the context I bring it up. And again, just let them know this is something I bring up with all my patients. And it's a little harder on the wards, especially when you're attending for a month and you haven't seen this person before in your life. And they're going into surgery or something the next day, but it's very applicable. And also elicit important values to them. If they're kind of hem-hawing or on the fence, or you don't know if they really understand the meaning, ask them, what makes life worth living to you? And if they say, being active, perking, walking around, talking, enjoying my family, then you can kind of work with them gradually on what that means. A lot of people have preconceived notions on what a do not resuscitate means. They think do not care or do not treat. So a lot of times you've got to go into the discussion that no, that we're only deciding if your heart were to stop, would you want to be shocked or CPR? Or if you were to quit breathing, would you want us to breathe artificially for you? So sometimes you got to really kind of break it down so that they don't think DNR is a, you know, walk away, we're sending you to a greenhouse to be, you know, turned and watered once a day. So that's something very important to them. And also, what makes life not worth living to you? So everyone's a little different on what's, you know, some people can deal with a lot of pain. They've been dealing with it for a long time. But you got to find out what's important to them as an individual. And again, address a limited number of issues all at one time. I try not to walk in and, you know, start some investigative reporter type mentality where, you know, they feel like they're under the gun. Because a lot of times, the more things you hit a person with, the more likely they're going to say no. Without even really knowing the information, because that's an automatic, give me time to reset. You know, kind of like rebooting your computer. If you throw too much at them, all of our first inclination when somebody calls you and says, can you do this, no, you know, you've got to stop. So go in barely with what's most applicable in a little bit of time. So advanced care planning is not necessarily just a one-stop shop, one visit, get it all out of the way, buffet-style Markov thing. It's just not that easy. And then it's important, though, especially with the CPR, and especially nowadays with artificial hydration and nutrition, what their wishes are. And again, without villainizing or one way or the other, just again, just giving them information, letting them choose. And then the most, of course, thing is once they have chosen, either way, if they're over, you know, if they have decision-making capacity, people can make bad decisions. So you document it and then you readdress it in the future is how you do. You can only, you know, some people have to take little bits, multiple small feedings instead of one large bolus. And then review and update documents regularly. So again, as their condition changes and the time goes on, again, that doesn't mean once a DNR, always a DNR, not once a full coat, always a full coat. So as you can see on this, it's not the ideal situation when the doctor says, I'm sorry, Mrs. Smith, but without a living will, I can't turn the machine off. It's not quite that bad, but especially since it says Mrs. Smith, but a lot of times we end up, you know, the mentality of, well, you know, he didn't tell me specifically that he didn't want this, then so we're stuck in here forever. So really the conclusions are that it's a communication process. It's not an event. It's not like you had your first tooth. It's not like, you know, I had to sign up for the selective service because I turned 18. It's, you know, something that I think is, especially as a new patient or somebody that you haven't found documented, whether you're seeing him as an outpatient or any other time, that's something that just needs to be brought up. We ask about smoking, drinking, drugs. So it's not like we can't say we're embarrassed to go there. We've asked them about sexual contacts, drugs, and everything else. I'm like, what's one more thing about what do you want to do when you die? You know, so think about it. You're like, well, you know, it's kind of like, okay, you've gone much deeper than many people are comfortable with already. So what's a little bit more? And then also it should be part of routine care. And again, explain that to the patient. This is something I ask all my new patients. This is something I ask all my patients when they're admitted to the hospital. This is something I have to ask. Again, that makes the patient feel at ease in the sense, what does he know I don't? No, seriously, you can actually unmask something. You know, someone's coming in, well, I was just coming in because I broke my hip. What does he know I don't know? What came up, you know? So instead of starting that whole roller coaster or snowball effect, just say, hey, you know, anyone admitted, again, electively or traumatically or surgery, you know, however, this is part of routine care, is for us to know your wishes. And I just tell them, my personal feeling is, I need to know what you want to have done to you, and I feel that if I don't ask you, I don't want to do something to you that you wouldn't have done, want to have done. And I'm very blunt with that part. And, you know, whether they decide to go with it or without it, again, that's a judgment call for them, so. But to give them the most information. Again, documentation. Without documentation, it just makes the next person's life miserable. So if you have something, whether you're outpatient, whether you're inpatient, and this time, you know, they're not here for a terminal event, or they're with a cancer or something, but you send them home for home hospice, it's important to go ahead and get that document. So in case they are brought back emergently or something slips or something happens, then you're not making the next person's life difficult. And also the provider should initiate the discussions. Again, most of the patients are afraid they're going to click off something in you that you're, you know, what am I telling my doctor if I go ahead and tell him that I would like to die if I'm dying? No, I mean, a lot of them just, you know, that's not something you want to bring up. I mean, I'm like, and a lot of people were like, well, I don't know. I'm like, and then something as basic as herbals they're not going to tell you about. What do you think they're going to do? Just bring up, oh, by the way, if I'm looking like I ain't going to make it, you know, just turn it off. And no, it's just not a natural flow for things for most folks. And so planning ahead for your health care now while you're able to is, again, a gift for you, but also for their family members and everyone else. And again, that's one thing I stress to my patients. I said, this is not only helping you and helping me, but this is going to alleviate a lot of guilt and stress on your family members when the time does come, because they know they're not having to feel like they're the one making the decision. They knew what you wanted. And again, I tell them that they're really just your voice to advocate what they would have wanted to have done, not the one to decide whether to discontinue therapy. So any questions?
I think I heard you say that you do not require your hospice patients that come inpatient to have a DNR.
No. And, yeah. And actually, legally, you really can't to, you can't really deny hospice as a benefit based on them having a DNR. So it gets kind of that, to me it just tips off, well, this is somebody that I need to go talk to. Again, I see it as, well, why aren't they not? So then that's the multiple small feedings. Is there's this daughter I don't know about, they had a fight, you know, 10 years ago and they haven't talked to since, and in their mind there's unfinished business, and maybe that's the reason they're not ready for that yet or not. So again, you kind of, that just means I need to go do multiple kind of checking in with them to see why they're not really going there. Is it they're in that denial anger phase of grief? Are they, is there unfinished goals or business that I might need to even help them with? Do I need to get a chaplain involved? Do I need to get, you know? So to me, that's just a tip off that I might need to actually work a little bit more with them.
And the other question I have is, and this is something that we frequently struggle with in this facility, and that is that there's almost a stigma with patients who have a DNR documented on the chart, and there's a physician order for do not resuscitate. And I think part of it is because we have so many fellows, residents, and students that come through here. But frequently, they will say to, for example, Mary John might call the middle of the night and say, I'm transferring this patient who's tachypneic febrile and I think might have pneumonia.
Yeah.
And they'll say, well, don't send in these a DNR.
I know.
Do y'all struggle with that?
I see that on even attendings. And I tell them, it's do not resuscitate. It doesn't mean
do not treat.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And it only reflects too if your heart or lung stops and they're not stopped right now, so that means
in a teaching environment, what I try and do is first I take a deep breath, and then I count to 10, and then I say, okay, what are you making that decision based off of? Especially if it's a trainee. I try not to, rip their head off. But I try to walk them through the process of what does a DNR mean? Okay, so how are you coming to your conclusion that you're not going to treat with antibiotics? What, you know, so I try to be more supportive. It depends on the environment. When I was in the military, it's a little different. But when I'm teaching a hospital, I'm like, you know, because part of my teaching, you know, in an educational institute is trying to get rid of some of these myths. And
I thought maybe it was just something we were doing wrong.
No,
no,
not anybody has a problem. And the other thing that I see them is they think that it's like a checklist, like, okay, you want two compressors
style.
And
I know. They're like,
or patients say, oh, can you just try for 1 minute and then stop?
Give it a good try.
Yeah, give
I'm
it
like,
a good try.
What does that mean?
And then if it doesn't work, and so I'm like, no, this is like an all or nothing.
Yeah. I don't do the buffet style. Mm-hmm. I'm like, DNR is not meant to, you know, push on my chest for 3 minutes if the light doesn't turn green on my forehead. Then go away. It's literally if your heart stops.
Have you read through the new ET10, the advanced directives that the middle part that says how strict do you want me to?
I know. I'm just like,
and it's just more confusing.
Yeah, and that's why I'm just really, you know, even without that form, I just sit down with them. I'm like, no, what I'm wanting to know is, and again, that's why we're kind of changing some of the terminology. We'd like to go do not attempt resuscitation, because a lot of the context of do not resuscitate means, well, you're not doing something that would have automatically worked. You know, and by saying do not resuscitate, you're giving the idea that just by not doing it, then you have already done the negative. Whereas if do not attempt means on a good day, on a 20-year-old with no other medical problems, and you get there in the first 30 seconds, then you might have a chance. You know what I mean? So a lot of it's just getting the idea over that the difference between attempting to resuscitate something versus, well, you know, by just me not doing it, then, you know, you would have been able to if I had.
Usually the way I go kind of with the statistics for the patients is that I tell them that that we can try to bring you back, and then that's allow natural death or try to bring you back is the other language I use. And then it's like, oh, okay, from then I'm done. But I tell them also the numbers. The chance that I try to bring you back and give it a whole try and that you're actually back and you're talking to me like you're now and you're
you
back
walk
at home
out of the
and
hospital,
not
what are
talking
your chances?
And not with machines is less than 1 in 100. And then it's like, oh, okay. And we actually, and like for trainees, that's powerful, and I actually have like the reference. It's this JAMA article, and then it's like, okay, so it's not like made up, because when you look at the resuscitation studies and you're looking not just that they survive 2 hours to code again in 2 hours or 2 days, or but when you're looking at discharge from the hospital alive 1 year, it's they
left like you came in or better.
Yeah.
You, you know.
Not and that and that kind of brings it down to earth for both patients and trainees.
Just before you tell them about their broken ribs. And
I know.
Yeah, and then it's, and then I go into this pretty graphic, and I could break your ribs. And
well, as soon as I'll say something like, you know, it's not a very dignified way to die.
That's, yeah. Mm.
It's not very dignified.
Yeah.
It's people swarming all over your body. You know, you almost become a, you almost become non-human. Like, I don't say that, but just
yeah.
try to sort of say, you know, it's not really.
And towards the end of life, especially, a lot of times you have to turn off monitors, get families comfortable with turning. Because a lot of times we can consult when they're still in the PCU step-down unit, or they're transitioning out of the ICU. And if you give them their pain medicine, their blood pressure goes down, an alarm goes off. So they're like, literally have this patient just in agony, and you're bolused all your fluids, you've done all these fun things to play with the numbers, and sometimes you really got to let them know, are we going to treat the numbers, or are we going to treat the patient? And sometimes it's difficult, but that was one of my, we had a, I don't know, Bonnie,
mm-hmm.
you remember
yeah.
that case? Yeah.
And they're always focused on that monitor.
And you know,
they're
they,
watching the monitor
yeah.
and they're kind of leaving mm-hmm. the patient behind.
Yeah.
yeah.
You should be having conversations and mm-hmm. not so having someone come and pinch you and get blood. And
yeah, so sometimes it's just a matter of letting them know it's okay. And do we want to treat his pain, or do we want to treat his numbers? So it gets down that basic sometimes.
In a situation like this, when you have the family in there, do you ask them to leave, or do you let them stay and just sit here?
Usually, I mean, anytime during a code, it really depends on, I mean, I'm used to clearing the room myself. Have I had a family member that kind of stuck around sometimes? It really depends on the patient, but sometimes I've had family members, while you're doing the code, I step out and, you know, let them know how it's going, because sometimes they'll rescind. They'll go to DNR even during the code. So what I do is I have them step out but stay close by. And if you literally, if you go through the whole ACLS thing and you know, you're down to like the 12th drug and you forgot your, you know, your short, you know, your algorithm and everything else by that point, you're looking at your little book on the code card to what's next. Then you step out and let them know it's not looking good. Yeah, so literally I sometimes make sure they stay close, because literally some patients who their family's like full co, literally in the middle of the code, after they realize that we have given more than the normal, they'll go ahead and say, okay, that's fine, let's withdraw.
But
so I keep them close.
Yeah, in our ward, I mean, we try to do convince people, well, I guess just lay it out for them so that they may be DNR, because if they're in an inpatient hospice unit and with people that are dying, and the neighbor in the next bed gets coded, it's not a pretty sight. Plus, you know, the nursing staff's not trained to do that, and the code card doesn't arrive, and then the stuff.
Well, one of your aspects of having a hospice is to have a calm, nurturing environment.
Right.
And if you've got somebody being coded in the third room, that is the last thing you've got. Your environment is ruined for a day and a half. I'm sorry.
So even though it's not required, I mean, we really
yeah.
work hard on getting.
So that's why I look at it as really that's somebody I need to go back and check on frequently. And sometimes I'm really blunt with them. I'm like, what, you know, I find like, well, what's making you hold on? What do you, are there any things that you feel like you need to finish before your illness takes you? And sometimes they'll finally blurt out, well, you know, I have this son that I haven't talked to, and last time we talked, we fought. And if that means just getting a phone call to him and stuff, sometimes it, so it makes me to just keep in a good way trying to figure out what I can do to help this person go to the next step, as to, you know, okay, he's full, you know, and then I just write it and then I'm like, whatever. But so that tells me I need to go in there and just work a little bit more and find out what's going on. Do they not just understand? Because some patients get confused with the difference with like palliative chemo and palliative radiation therapy. I mean, the difference between palliative and curative is huge, but a patient just hears chemo. A patient only hears radiation therapy. And so
or
they assume something's being done.
Or 15% chance of
yeah.
recovery sounds to them that they have a chance of cure and reading, well.
So part of it's debriefing, as I call it. You got to make sure what's been told to them to get them to this perception. So everyone's different too. So bless their hearts. Any other questions or?
Move on to the next one. So now that he's doing so badly.
Okay, so what's that? The cure then last days. I wish it was always that easy. The patient was transferred to the inpatient hospice unit. Mr. Miguel's pain is controlled. He dies surrounded by his girlfriend and family peacefully. So again, sometimes family members, I have to take a side without the patient. I'm like, this is his death. This isn't your death. You know, whatever issues you have with his girlfriend, this isn't the time. You're going to, don't make this something you're going to regret in 10 years that you totally did not focus on Grandpa Miguel in the most important times of his life because you couldn't get past the fact of his girlfriend Mary being there. Said, get over yourself. This is not your death. So some people, you just have to really bring them to reality, you know, bring them in a nice way, of course. May not be quite that blunt, but everyone's a little different. So this is the last hours of live talk. So the first thing is assessment of Grandpa Miguel. He's terminally ill with metastatic renal cell carcinoma. Of course, an illness that we all know really cannot be cured really with the current available treatments we have. So the main goals really are comfort, support, and support again being the true biopsychosocial, spiritual aspects, not just symptoms. You want to make sure, you know, there's no anguish, whether it be physical, whether it be psychological, whether it be spiritual. You want to cover all aspects if possible. And then you also want to protect him from iatrogenic harm. So, you know, again, first do no harm. So you can treat the symptoms, but at least use medications that are going to do it with less likelihood of causing untoward effects or making him potentially feeling worse. Some of the life's sources of suffering and end of life are pain, dyspnea, anorexia, nausea and vomiting, constipation, asthenia, skin breakdown, dysphagia, problems with secretions and incontinence. So we've all kind of seen these. Everyone's a little different. And sometimes you treat the family more than you're really treating the patient. You know, same way in pediatrics, half the time you're treating the parents, not the kid. You know, it's the same way at the end of life sometimes. And as long as it's not causing harm to the patient or anything, sometimes we do make a few, you know, instances where we can help with the symptoms. So again, emotional, whether it be delirium, depression, or anxiety, getting to the nitty-gritty, the dirt of this, and then deciding what medication, whether with anxiety you tend to have better response usually with benzodiazepines, versus depression, you have better luck with antidepressants. With delirium, you tend to have better luck with antipsychotics. At this point in time, it depends if they're able to take oral medication as to what agent you're using, especially with delirium. If they're still taking by mouth, then you've got the whole array of options. If they're not taking anything by mouth, then you're pretty well limited to Haldol because most of the atypicals aren't available by other routes. Social lack of financial resources, again, you've got to be aware of what's going on. Why is the family resistant to them being moved? What are they worried about? Why is the patient holding on sometimes? I probably haven't even shared this with my own group, but one of the things that with my own grandmother, she was dying of colon cancer, and we couldn't figure out why she was really holding on, and finally we had to just promise her that we would take care of Grandpa. And then she was able to leave peacefully. She held on for many months, and we just couldn't figure out, you know, she had really strong religious beliefs, she didn't have anything else. So again, finding out why this person isn't peacefully transitioning sometimes is important. Whether it just be assurance that you'll take care of Grandpa, whether it's, finding out what is lacking for them to be able to finish off the transition peacefully. And also inadequate housing, lack of full-time caregiver, and then spiritual anguish is, again, just as important as pain. It's just as bad as anything else. If you don't treat the spiritual anguish, you're not going to treat the discomfort. And it's going to be manifested in so many different ways. You'll be chasing your tail, and you're really not helping them. So it's really important. Again, everyone is different, so you got to find out at what level they're comfortable with their religiosity and religion, and then help them in any way possible. Also, IV fluids and central lines become an issue. Blood work, ABGs. On the acute care side, sometimes we get to where we have, especially being an internist by nature, I want numbers. I want to have my Chem 99 every day, even if I don't need it. You know, so we got to be able to back off at some point. And are we sticking this person for something we really need or not? Now, sometimes we need to do blood work towards end of life, but we need to justify it and not just have them routine Chem 20 every day. So we got to look at every step, just like whenever somebody runs a fever, you got to look at every tube, plug, cord, and find out why it's there and how long it's been there. And also, again, any NG tubes, PEG tubes, TPN, catheters, rectal tubes, oxygen masks, non-rebreathers, BiPAPs. A lot of these, especially if someone's got dyspnea, you can think of the claustrophobic effects. Some people find comfort in masks, so you got to kind of find out what works best for that individual. Also, intubation, suctioning, nasal trumpet. When sometimes if you get somebody from the unit, they'll still have all half these things sticking out of every orifice and a few they've made along the way. So you sometimes are the one taking these things out, and sometimes you just explain to them. So you got to be careful with that. And then again, CPR and attempted resuscitation and restraints. Sometimes we got to be careful because somebody called a code, there's some things a soft code. You know, somebody got a little hypoxic for a little bit, they called a code. Versus a true, you know, diehard code, you know, code. Their heart stopped, you know. So you got to kind of figure out what really happened in the code. If they were a little hypotensive or not. And then separation from family and loved ones is important. So again, resuscitation is not an effective treatment at life's ends. You're really prolonging a natural process. You're not really changing anything. And again, we're going to more of the do not attempt resuscitation terminology, to preferably instead of do not resuscitate. Again, trying not to give the connotation to others that this is something that we're just withholding from the patients, instead of this is something that we're going above and beyond, and hopefully something happened and it turned out good. You know, so it's part of it's how we even suggest it and talk to others. Order a diet. The patient may not even eat, but sometimes there's smell sensation. They'll want to smell it even if they don't want to eat it. So you really got to ask, because other patients might get nauseated by smelling food. So you really got to kind of find out what works for each individual. Full liquids instead of clears. You may have the food brought in. I don't think you need to worry about their cardiac diabetic salt prune diet whenever the person is in their last days. I've seen that in some places, and it just drives me nuts. Especially in failure to thrive in geriatrics alone, much less palliative care. I'm like, oh my goodness, think about it. But anyways, so if the patient will eat, let them. If they don't want to eat, don't force them. Just let them go, let nature, how they're comfortable. Allow them to be as active as they want to be. Again, whether that's in a chair, looking out the window at the pretty scenery, getting up among the grandkids. The whole idea, again, with hospice is letting them do what they want to, being as comfortable as possible and interacting with as many people as possible while they're doing it. And allow the family to stay in the room if possible, depending on your room situations. Vital signs, again, what are you doing? Are you just giving yourself numbers to feel better about? Why? You know, this person is here for comfort care. Why are you waking them up every 4 hours to check a blood pressure? The one thing you're looking for is going to be obvious when it's time. I don't think you need to necessarily be tracking a blood pressure so often. And also the notification orders. You know, we get these ICU parameters of blood pressure this or that and pulse ox this and that, and it gets stuck on the chart. And if you don't really watch what gets moved over or something, if somebody else orders your entries, you need to chill out a little bit. Because again, you're really causing distress on this person if you're giving them numbers that they become concerned about as well. IV considerations, starting's often difficult and painful. Really, a lot of times it's no benefit to the patient. A lot of patients already have fluid overload, edema, and pulmonary congestion. They also have limited movement. So oral hydration is usually reasonable, but once if they can't, then IV fluids can be used, but only on certain amounts at a time. And then also, you can sometimes go to subcutaneous instead of IV, which is a lot of times a little bit easier. And you just use a little butterfly needle inserted, and you can do small volumes. And like the hypodermoclysis, you can do half normal saline, usually at a rate of 30 to 45 cc's per hour if you need to rehydrate somebody instead of using an IV. The sub-Q is a lot easier, less painful, and usually. And a lot of medications can be given in that same little butterfly that you can, you know, keep, and you know, if you need to. And even sometimes the push driver syringes, if you're in a home hospice environment, they can have medications given through a needle driver type of apparatus. Also, pain and dyspnea, opioids are usually most effective in this setting. We used to do the nebulized morphine, but we found out in the studies that the nebulized saline was just as good. So a lot of times it sounded cool and it made sense, we thought, but we found out it really just didn't pan out. So it's cheaper just to, if they need some mist, fine, try just a saline neb. If they don't, just put a fan and go from there. And otherwise, just really you want to treat the reflex symptom of the dyspnea. So a lot of times morphine is usually what the patient is going to really be needing for the dyspnea. And then also sometimes the dexamethasone can be used. Sometimes though, you got to really worry about fluid overload, long-term patients. So I try not to go there if I don't have to, but sometimes it does help. Now, nausea and delirium, Haldol, the nice thing about it can be used as an antiemetic as well as for a delirium medication. It can also be given in multiple avenues, like sub-Q, where, of course, with the atypicals, you couldn't. So that's one drug. It's chemically related to chlorpromazine and less sedating, so that's one drug that we tend to use. Lorazepam may also be helpful, especially with anxiety or delirium secondary to benzo withdrawal or to alcohol withdrawal. It's the only time your preference is a benzo over an antipsychotic in delirium, is usually whenever it's due to alcohol or benzo withdrawal. And it's also, but it's not really effective against seizures by PO. So of course, if you're using for seizures, it's IV or sub-Q. Now for dyspnea again, nasal problems, you got to find the patient. Some people are comforted by having something on their face. Most people throw it off, especially like BiPAP. You know, if you start trying to stick somebody on BiPAP, it's not the most natural sensation, having something on your face and pushing against your breathing. And you usually don't monitor the oxygen. Again, are you treating the numbers or are you treating the patient? Now, that's another source of anxiety. It adds a noise in the room. It adds, you know, again, it's just a dynamic you don't want to be chasing. And again, blowing air on the face I found to be just as good as to many other things, along with the nasal cannula and the morphine, turning, repositioning, keeping them busy. You got to be careful with nebs with albuterol or Xopenex because it can cause some reflex tachycardia and anxiety. So sometimes you can get some anxiety if you do tons of nebs that way. And also, again, avoid the face mask because it avoids difficulty with them communicating. And they sometimes need restraints. Now, the so-called death rattle, again, is usually something you're really treating the patient's family for. By that time, it's usually not really causing the patient much distress, but it's very distressing to many of those in the room. So a lot of times we treat that with a scopolamine patch. You can put that on, change it every 3 days. If that's, until that kicks in, or if it's not effective, you can use the atropine eye drops, putting it in their mouth every 4 hours or until the patch is effective. You really want to avoid the deep suctioning. Sometimes you would get a little yonker happy. You know, you don't want to go digging for tonsils. So do the mouth care gently. Again, if their mouth is dry. Again, as a nurse before I went to med school, we used to use glycerin swabs on everything that moved. Then we found out the glycerin swabs are actually drying effect. So now we've actually gone away from using those lemon glycerin swabs. So now we wet a moist cloth and dampen their tongue, you know, put it on their tongue, let them keep it in their mouth. Whatever you can do short of using any other agents that might be worse. But you can have the families cleanse the mouth with the sponge sticks or those little mint pink things. I guess they still make those. I'm dating myself now. On the stick that you can do the mouth with the oral care and stuff. Sad. And then soda washes also. Avoid Foley catheters if you can, unless it just really causes super distress on the patient. Even towards the end, it was just a real big loss. To them, it was a feeling of loss of independence by having incontinence. So for them, I ended up using a catheter because to them, that person, that was just something worse than death, you know, was to have incontinence in front of their family members. So again, but for the most part, you can just take care of them that way. Also comforting measures, repositioning. We used to do the back rubs, but again, we found out in people with bony prominences, we actually did more damage from, we found from the some of the nursing studies. So especially on the bony little old people that are in bed. I don't know, when I was going through nursing school, you know, they did all the back rubs and massages and all that kind of stuff. But then we found out if you really hyper massage those areas, especially over the bony prominences, you actually cause shearing forces that can actually promote skin breakdown further than, you know, we used to think that promoted blood flow and that would help it, but we actually found the shearing forces that actually made it worse. So if you can kind of give a gentle massage, that's fine, but if you're trying to do that to prevent decubiti, then it's not really been helpful. And then minimize discomfort. You know, just because we like a TV on in the background at home doesn't mean everyone likes CNN blaring in their room. Some people love it. You know, my parents, bless their hearts, I don't know how they can sleep if they keep that thing on and loud, but it works for them. So again, you got to find out what works for that patient. And it's better to use a bed minder, like a bed alarm that you can put under their butt instead of, I mean, the old ones we hooked up to the bed and it turned on the alarm, but you can also do those at the pull vests and the little pull tabs that, you know, to tell if they're getting a little too rambunctious in the rooms versus actually tying them down. Some of the things you got to remember with a family is if they have real concern is when it comes to hunger, the family see that sometimes as nurturing. So sometimes you'll like, these family aren't really getting this idea about their GI tract is shut down. I've given the whole physiologic talk about this is part of the dying process. So sometimes distract them with other things of nurturing. You know, let them find other ways of showing love.
Just refocus.
Yeah.
Because at least in the Hispanic culture, everywhere you go, here's food. Hi, here's eat your soup.
I mean, so some people that is, it's a, you know, so really you just find other ways of letting them show nurture. So, and in summary, don't worry. This is a quote. It's kind of strange, but anyways, strange humor. Don't worry. You will all die successfully. Some do it better than others, I guess, though. There are different metal categories. If there is a sacred moment in the life cycle other than a birth, it is in death. It is a natural transition. As with birth, families will long remember how a person died and how we helped or did not. A bad death will stay in a family member's lives for the rest of their lives. A good death will also stay in their lives, but not for the same reason, thank goodness. So just remember that you've touched their lives for forever, whether they're a child at the bedside that hasn't quite figured it out. So you can touch many generations in a family and for the rest of their lives by how you handle this. And we need to relearn how to coach patients and family members through the last 24 hours. We coach people through birthing, we coach people through this, we coach them through everything else. Again, why not? Nice. Not everyone's read your palliative care book on what to expect, you know. So again, part of our job is a positive in the sense that we are giving this person the best life and also the best transition possible. And are there any questions or commentary?
Comments. I'm sure in your units, like we have patients that the families send flowers or after they die. And like when I was a fellow, there was this family that I was part of the team taking care of, and then recently, you know, by the union and say, look, there's those flowers and your name is in it. And then I guess sure enough, they remember this was the anniversary of this person that had died, and here we are 2 years later and the family knew everybody, my name was there, and I just couldn't remember by, you know, anything, but it really did make a difference to that family, and I think that's the blessing of our job, that we make difference in an important stage of families. Well, I guess close to being done on time, and if you can, I've seen some of you filling out those evaluations. They'll help us help you better in the future, so please fill them out. And
yeah, welcome any comments and suggestions. Yeah, we're always trying to improve.
You can give them all to me so I can mail them back. And.
You read Maricela's instructions? Oh, there's a certificate.
Thank you.
We try to keep it friendly.